totally agree that it is not the next platform that is going to replace mobile. I don't think, I don't know what will have a kind of a personal scale that will exceed mobile for many years. But I've been doing research in virtual reality for education for about 6 years. And from the research world, I can tell you there's some pretty amazing things that brands can do with virtual reality. But most of them will not, because most of them won't understand how it works or why it's powerful. But this presentation is going to focus on mobile security and the future of mobile security. And I want to tell you kind of in advance, this is not a cybersecurity presentation. This is not a presentation full of tricks and techniques to keep the enterprise secure. But what I'm really looking at is what will security mean in the future to users? How will they think about what security means? How will they think about what privacy means? What are the emotions? What are the experiences? What are the expectations in this world where we're going? Because we're going into a very, very different world powered by technology that's going to have some amazing superpowers, but it's going to change our relationship to brands, and it's going to change our relationship to trust pretty fundamentally. So a little bit of my background, I teach at a military university, so I'm not the normal person you're going to have talking about brand experiences. But what I teach at the military university in Germany is I teach my students about what digital power means and how digital technology is changing human society and how it's changing their individual lives. I also work with them to stretch their knowledge and to really show them how they can learn in a very different way in the digital age than they were ever able to before. So just as one example, we did a project about 4 years ago. I was trying to help them understand how this dropping of price in technology was changing power relationships. So I asked them to build a drone that could fly to a roof and hack the Wi-Fi network. This was 4 years ago. They had to build this from the component level. And they all said, we can't do this. We're law students, we're social science students, we don't know how to do this. And I said, yeah, I know you don't know how to do this. You certainly don't have the skills or the knowledge now. But I give you a budget, and you have the internet. And with those two things, you're gonna be able to solve the problem. And they did, 3 months later. The helicopter that they built flew by itself, landed on a rooftop, and hacked the Wi-Fi network. And they came out of it telling me they felt like the Wright brothers must have felt when the first plane took off. And this idea was really, what is the power that comes to us when we have all of these new technologies that are becoming much cheaper and much more accessible? So I also do some consulting with some hacker colleagues, with companies, with clients, to sort of help them improve their digital security. So I'll just do a very brief version here. When we talk about mobile security, I'll talk about three very, very brief things if you really wanted to improve your overall mobile security. First of all, use iOS. Android is a less secure environment only because it's more fragmented. It's not really serious problems, though, that we're seeing from the mobile world for enterprises. So when we look at all of the data breach reports that we get, when we look at all of the impact on companies and their data, very, very few of it, very, very little is coming from mobile. It's not an important way that hackers gain access into enterprises. But it is a very important way that hackers might gain access to your life. And that's mostly through the services that people use through those devices. So the one thing that I would say that everyone should do is use a password manager. Our password system, the security system that we use, is fundamentally broken. There is no way for you to remember strong, unique passwords for all of your 75 different services that you probably use. You might be able to, but you're superhuman then. Most of us will have to use some service that creates and manages those for us. And if you do that, you protect yourself from something called account rolling. That is where a hacker gets the piece of data that is your email login and your password from a website hacking and uses it to hack all of the other sites that use the same password and login combo. It's a very, very common way for people to experience devastating cyber attacks, personally. And this one, I would say, have a recovery plan. When we're working with industry players, the most important theme that we face right now is resilience. Attacks will happen, period. The question is, how will you recover after the attack? Loss will happen. How do you recover after the loss? So I was thinking about this today because as I was coming here and I went to the train station and I opened up my wallet, I realized I'd left my credit card at home on the kitchen table. And, you know, the first sort of shock to me was, oh, shit, you know, what am I going to do now? I don't have my credit card. How am I going to get to, well, okay, no, I've got my cash card. Okay, I'll get more cash. Not a big problem. But it started me thinking about, what if I lost my mobile phone on the way here? Would I have been able to fly? Would I have been able to get into my hotel? Would I even know how to figure out where my hotel was? Think about what would happen on an average day if you lost your mobile phone. Like, more and more of our life is pouring into this one device. And the ability to recover what gets lost there is becoming more and more important. So I won't go into too much detail about this. If you want to ask any questions about personal cybersecurity, we can talk afterwards. What I want to talk a bit more about is the attitudes towards security, the attitude towards things like privacy. Now, I've been studying this for about 5 or 6 years. And a lot of it has been surveys with companies, surveys with students, their attitudes towards privacy. And so this is from, by the way, the last sort of report on how mobile is eating the world. And it's a fantastic report that I would highly recommend looking at, produced by Andreessen Horowitz. But this graph here is showing kind of the uptake of smartphones and iOS and Android devices. And how, once you get to about 2012, you've passed the point where there are more of these devices than there are PCs around the world. And it's interesting because about this point here, when I was talking to people about security, their questions were always focused on, what does this device know about me? Like, what do the companies that run these apps, what are they finding out about me? And there was a lot of discussion, like, in this period where this was really taking off, that looked like this. You know, your phone is watching. It's very ominous, like, my privacy and my data is being lost. I'm losing control. And we absolutely did lose control. And that ended up, for most people, being a good thing. So when I ask this question now, like, well, I'd ask her, is anyone here worried that your phone is watching you? You're worried that your phone is watching you?
Yeah.
What are you worried about?
My privacy, and info to be sent to a bird or a client, since they're in all my private life, smartphone.
So you're worried about what Apple or what Google might do with your information?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
I agree.
Thomas, you said you're worried about your phone watching you.
So I know the whole hidden or best thing that is happening in the background. Not maybe Apple or Google. Apple stands for privacy these days, but at the end of the day, what some other vendors are doing when they're, you know, reuse this data, it's supposed to be anonymous, but it can super easily be, you know, de-anonymized.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, this idea about where our data goes after someone collects it, after they resell it, after it goes on to other points. Do we lose control of our lives because more and more people can look into it? I would say we're starting to flip this, though, for many people. Like, if I'd asked this question in 2012, 2013, I would expect most hands would have gone up. Like, now if you ask me, am I worried if my phone is watching me? I'm worried if my phone is not watching me. Because this is when I came here today. All right? So this is Google, who's now borrowed information from my app that is processing my ticket. So it's taking it from Lufthansa, It's coordinating with my calendar and my location to say, in the place you are right now, you need to leave if you want to get to this plane on time. But you think about all the different data sharing that's going on and how much they learn about my life to provide this service. We're going to have more and more expectations that this kind of thing happens. We're going to want for smart applications and smart companies to be watching us. And this is really, I think, a big change that's happening because of what Apple and Google have really adopted as their philosophies. And it's changing a lot of public perceptions of the issue of privacy and security. So Apple is saying that the data encryption, that your personal data is they want to encrypt that by default. They want that to make that the standard. And they're not going to be reselling your data. They're not necessarily collecting it and selling it to the highest bidder. That's a very, very powerful business model. So when you look at how Apple is fighting with the FBI, it is fundamentally a question about the future of the business. If people cannot trust us, a city that I know is amazing, but I don't know very well, I'm excited because I hope when I come here that Google knows that I like to see rock and roll in small venues, I like a certain type of restaurant, and when I get to my hotel, it asks me, what do I want to go see and what do I want to go do, and it gives me recommendations, very much like if I was talking to another human being, if I was talking to someone who was local. And when I say, I want to go to this rock show, and I want to eat at this restaurant, it'll ask me when I want to go there. And it will make the phone call, and it will talk to the person at the restaurant to make the booking. Facebook already does this in the US on the West Coast with M. It makes the calls for you. Then it's going to send the car to me, and the car probably won't have a driver. That's awesome. That's like being somebody who lived in this place. Seriously. It's like having servants out in the real world who know you and who do things for you. That's incredible. But it's gonna mean that the services I use, I will have to trust them in a different way. Because I'm not just worried about whether or not my data is secure from hackers. Like we talk in the information security world about confidentiality, integrity, and accessibility of data. We've been worried very much about confidentiality, which is privacy. Well, integrity of the data is the thing doing what I want it to do. The accessibility, can I use the thing when I want to? Those will become more important questions because I will be putting my body inside these technologies. I will be trusting that these technologies protect my house. I will trust that these technologies let me get inside my house. This is a very different set of questions and a very different type of relationship to technology. It's not just about whether my data is hidden from other people. So I think these are two nice ways to frame it. Okay, now you could say that this is a wired writer who's very excited about AI. Maybe overly so, right? The business plans of the next 10,000 startups are using the forecast. Take X and add AI. Okay, why is that important? I will tell you that I've been trying to wrap my head around AI for years now. It's very hard to because there are a lot of kind of mixed up concepts. It's not like human intelligence in many ways. In what cases am I going to imagine things I want it to learn about me that will help me? But here's a nice way to phrase it from the CEO of NVIDIA. NVIDIA is the company that's creating the processors that are driving a lot of the AI technology. And this is really where we see what the future expectation of our users is going to be for our brands, for our services, for our companies. Because they're going to be seeing more and more examples of where value is added because something becomes living. It has a capability to improve. It has a capability to learn. It has a capability to change. That will be very, very powerful because it will always give this sense that the thing that you buy, the relationship that you enter is alive. And I'll give you an example of a contrast between a company that I think gets it and a company that I think doesn't get it. And this is going to decide the future of a major industry in the world. And I'll also hint at how they go about the problem of security in this world, because security becomes much more complicated. There are far more things that you have to understand about security to really make it work. So every year, I take a select group of executives to DEF CON. DEF CON is the world's largest hacking conference. And at DEF CON, they all get a chance to get freaked out because they're afraid that if they bring their mobile devices, a hacker is going to break into it and steal everything, which is probably true. So they can't bring their smartphones, or they shouldn't bring their smartphones unless they're really, really certain they don't have sensitive technology they can access through it. But the most important reason that I bring them there is not to scare them. The reason that I bring them there is because I want to show them how this community learns, how this community educates itself, how this community shares knowledge, because this is a model for where we're going to have to go if we want to keep up with the changes that are happening. So the fundamental thing that you see happening at DEF CON is hackers sharing their information openly, sharing their problems openly. You can go to anyone at DEF CON who's working on something, even the guy who's really focused and is hacking away at something that looks like our stereotype of hacking, and you can say, what are you doing? And I promise you, that man or that woman will look up and say, oh, have a seat, I'll show you. And then they'll teach you. So this last year, Tesla had its first appearance at DEF CON. Right? They had a whole room devoted to auto hacking. And I'm sure part of it was trying to sell cars, because maybe this is their demographic. But the more important thing that was happening here is that the vehicles were completely open for anyone to go in and play with and try to break electronically. So they had all of their on-dashboard systems, they had all of their engine systems. You could hook up wires, you could hook up computers, you could see if you could crack them. Right? And on top of that, they offered $10,000 to anyone who could find a bug. Let me tell you why this is so cool and so powerful. This is because Tesla understands that as technology becomes more complex, and as technology becomes autonomous, we have to trust that with our lives. That is not about me losing a credit card. That is about me dying if this goes wrong. Right? The trust level is way higher. So what you can't do is you can't use the old solution to solving problems. And the old solution to solving problems was something similar to the Pareto principle, for the 80-20 principle. In the past, what you had to do when you had a problem is you had to sort of collect the best experts around that problem and ask them to solve it. Because this idea is that like 80% of the contributions are going to come from a small segment of a population. Like 80% of the value is going to be derived from 20% of the population. So if you're a company and you're treating this in the old way, you can't hire someone out here who only comes up with one good idea a year, because it's a waste of money. So what you do is you have your problem and you build an institution around that problem. And what we have now that everyone is networked, everyone is connected, everyone can solve problems from anywhere, is companies like Tesla know, you know what? I don't have to throw away 20% of the value anymore. I don't have to throw away 20% of the good contributions. Because what I can do is, yes, I can hire very skilled people. And then I can be transparent in my problems, and I can ask everyone to try to solve them. I can incentivize the world to try to break my systems and teach me how they do it. This is a very, very different way of solving a problem. This is a very different way of learning. It's a very powerful way. And I'll contrast that with a company that doesn't get it. And this happened the same week, by the way. The same week that we're watching Tesla solve its security problems, the story comes out that VW has spent 2 years trying to sue researchers, two academics, who found a security flaw. They tried to sue them to keep them from publishing the details of that flaw. Now maybe this is me being a bit extreme. It was not a surprise to me what we found out about VW later, because this says a lot about their culture. This says a lot about how they solve problems. This says a lot about how they think about the nature of problems. And I think it also shows a really important difference in how they think about what they're doing. Tesla knows that what it's selling you is it's selling you an iPhone in 2007. And that iPhone had what? It had a couple of apps on it. It was not really actually that exciting. It looked cool, but didn't do a whole lot else. But what they were really selling you is they were selling you the ability for that thing to get better and better and better over time. Because it was, as we all know now, the center of an ecosystem. It was something that was software-based. That's what Tesla is selling. That's why tech geeks love Tesla. Not only do they trust it more to solve really valuable, really important problems, they also trust that it will get better throughout the entire life of the vehicle. And it does. They do over-the-air updates. They change it. VW comes from the old model where when you sold something, it is done as soon as it leaves. It's finished. It is not changing. If we compare that to the iPhone, that is like Nokia saying, oh, you wanted a camera? We can put a camera on the phone. Or BlackBerry saying, oh, you want a web browser? We can put a web browser on there. That is not software at the heart of things. That is not, maybe I'll jump back to it here. That is not a living, breathing capability to improve. This is what we need when we move into the future for safety, for security, and certainly for customer engagement. You need that ability to learn and grow constantly. We have tools for that now. We have techniques. We have to put education and learning and networking much closer to the center. So some people argue that in the future every company is a software company. I argue that in the future every company is an education company. Education is at the heart of how you iterate. Education is at the heart of how you innovate. Education is at the heart of how you market. Education is in the heart of how you grow. So how do we bring this into our organizations to actually make value, to make valuable things? I will give you two things that I think are losing strategies. This is how I think you lose. So when you outsource innovation, you hope that somebody else does the thinking and the learning for you. You hope that some consultant comes in and gives you the answer. And observing from the sidelines, you wait and see, is this really a thing? I don't know, let's wait. I used to work in television many years ago. I had kind of a weird engineering background in television. And so I had a sense of how that industry was fundamentally disrupted by mobile and by digital. And when I talked to a good friend of mine last week, and we were talking about innovation, and we were talking about how that industry fundamentally got changed, how it was really fundamentally disrupted, like Thomas was talking about, massively disrupted industry. And I asked him, what's happening now? And his response was great. He said, well, there are two kinds of people here now. There are people who are running because they know that they're being chased by wolves. And there are people who are running because everybody else is running. Like, if you don't want to be behind this and be the person being chased by a wolf or just running because everyone else is running, you have to move forward in this. You have to take ownership over the innovation. You have to take ownership over the learning. So I'd ask you these questions. How are you reimagining your business in the future? And I don't mean just at a conference talking about it. This is cool, this is important. But I don't mean just sort of like, yeah, that's interesting. I mean, how are you working on this as a meaningful existential problem for the future of your business? How are you incubating new ideas for products and services? It is how are you really empowering the teams that are within your company to change and to grow and to learn? And how are you positioning yourself not just for surviving, not just hoping that the wolf catches somebody else, but how are you preparing to grow? That's the question. We're entering a very, very different world now. Like, if you thought that the changes that we saw up to now were weird, let me promise you, we are in a very primitive surveillance society. We are in a society that is very lightly touched by artificial intelligence. We are a society that's very lightly touched by robotics. And all of those things are going to be hitting very heavy, very soon. So I can go through this cycle. I won't go into too much detail about it, but when we work with companies, we're really thinking, how are you working this as a cycle so that you're actively thinking about what the trends are, what your opportunities are? That is learning, fundamentally. That is taking responsibility for doing the learning yourself. How are you connecting with knowledge networks? Like, first of all, who is the knowledge network? It's not just the consultants anymore. There are lots of communities of really smart people you can connect to, and there are different ways that you can connect to them now. How are you really enabling your team, giving them meaningful missions, and giving them the time that they need to learn? This will not work if everyone is maximized at 110% of their time, I promise you. And how are you really testing? How are you trying things out? How are you learning quickly? Those are great, great, great ways to move forward. And this group, and I think the sort of groups you represent, you're in, like, the situation we say for security is, things have never been worse, but I've never been more optimistic. You've never had more tools at your disposal. You've never had smarter people that you can connect to. You've never had more access to knowledge than you have now. This is a very exciting time to do very big things. And I'm very excited to see what this group does and how you move forward. Thank you.